Think we are ready? Yes. Okay, now we are welcoming Thomas Rasmussen, or aka Tykling, on the stage. You have, want to talk about Certgrinder.
Yes, thank you. Hello, everybody, and thanks for showing up. A while ago, I was, like many of you probably, have been switching to using Let's Encrypt for my certificates because it's free and it's easy and it's just very nice. I could do a whole talk on complaining about the CA model and the CA system and stuff. I won't be getting too much into that today, but I believe that Let's Encrypt is a very, very nice initiative, a very nice addition to what we had before. So while implementing Let's Encrypt on all my servers, I hit various snags along the road and wound up writing a piece of software called Certgrinder, which uses Let's Encrypt and the official Certbot client to get certificates, but in a different way that most people probably use it. It's a Python script and a little bit of POSIX shell, and it's really not that much code, and it's pretty simple once you wrap your head around it, and I think it's very clever. We're using it for all of the BornHack infrastructure and for all the my Uncensored DNS stuff and all my personal stuff and at my workplace as well, the ISP where I work, are all using Certgrinder in production for a year or something, or two. So, and it works very well. So I'll explain a bit more, a bit of background, and explain how it works, and apart from getting certificates, what else it does, and what I'm still planning to do that hasn't quite happened yet. Okay, so like I said, I love Let's Encrypt, but a few places, the regular Certbot client can be difficult to get to work. Say load balanced web servers, for example. So you have 10 web servers which have different IP addresses and an A record for your domain name, and the clients hit one of these 10 web servers on a random round robin type fashion. If I ran the Certbot client on one of these web servers, I couldn't be sure that the challenge, which Let's Encrypt does, would actually hit the same server, and I would have to do some sort of two-step thing where I make the challenge first and then distribute it to all the web servers and then make Let's Encrypt check and so on. It all gets a bit fiddly. There's also cases where DNS might not be pointing to the server that actually needs the certificate yet, because you're doing a migration from one server to another, and you would love to have the proper certificate already ready, already sitting on the server, but you can't, of course, because DNS is already pointing to the old server. Certgrinder is not the only piece of software written around Let's Encrypt. There's a whole bunch of alternatives, and I encourage you to check them out. They have various features, but I haven't found anything that does quite what I'm doing with Certgrinder. So what it does is it's an SSH proxy for Let's Encrypt use. So what you do is on your web server or mail server or wherever you need the certificate, you can contact the Certgrinder server over SSH, input a certificate signing request, a CSR, and then the Certgrinder server will do the validation and return a signed certificate over standard out on the SSH. So you have typical setup, you will have one Certgrinder server and as many clients as there are Certgrinder clients, but typically they will be servers themselves, like web servers and mail servers and stuff. But in the we call them clients here, so they are. There's no limit, theoretical limit, to how many clients you can have. On the clients, you run the Certgrinder Python script, which is where the bulk of the code is. And on the server, over SSH, they call the CSR grinder shell script, which in turn then calls Certbot and outputs the certificate in the end. That is the basics of it. That's almost too small to see, but the home, I usually do a dedicated user called Certgrinder on the servers, and the Certgrinder directory in the home directory of the user contains the code, and there's a config file, and there's a folder for certificates, and there's a virtual environment for the Python script. And in the certificates folder, they are completely standard certificates generated, could be generated with OpenSSL or anything. You have a key and a private key and the certificate signing request and the certificate itself, and then a concatenated file where they are mashed together in one file, because some pieces of software prefer that. Okay. Let's Encrypt has at the moment three different challenge types, but they recently disabled one, so they're down to two, because they found some vulnerabilities with the TLS stuff. So at the moment, to get a certificate from Let's Encrypt, you either have to verify over HTTP or over DNS. And what I do is with the Certgrinder is that on the web server, say if you use HTTP, you do a 301 redirect to the, in this case, this is from the BornHack web server. So any request that goes to the well-known ACME challenge where Let's Encrypt expects to find all the challenges is instead redirected with a standard HTTP redirect to the Certgrinder server, and which will be waiting with a challenge response. Or you can use DNS 01, which is basically the same. It expects to find the same secret, but in a record called ACME challenge dot and then the host name. So this is for our mail server, and basically they look up a record called ACME_ACME-challenge.imap.bornhack.org, and I create a CNAME which I point to a zone created just to handle the DNS challenges. So I basically do the same thing for HTTP and for DNS. I redirect the request from the server to the Certgrinder server. This means I can handle all the challenges in one place. I don't have to have, if I use DNS, I don't need any software on the clients at all. I don't need a listening web server or listening anything. So that is, that is an awesome way to serve the challenges, to use the DNS stuff, because you don't need any software at all on the client listening on, and you can even have it use it for servers that are on private networks and firewalled and stuff like that, because Let's Encrypt doesn't never have to connect to it. Okay, so when a server wants a certificate, it generates an SSH key, which is installed on the Certgrinder server in the authorized keys file. And then it generates a key pair and generates a certificate signing request containing the host names that it wants to use in that certificate. Then it SSHs to the Certgrinder server, and it is really this simple. You just cat the certificate signing request, SSH to the Certgrinder server, and then pipe the output into a certificate. And in the background, the CSR grinder script takes the certificate signing request, does some basic checking, and then calls Let's Encrypt with it. You can call the certbot script that Let's Encrypt provides with a bunch of options to make it use a CSR you provide and output the certificate on standard out and stuff. So it's a simple wrapper around the certbot binary, and you redirect the output into a file, and that's it. Then you have a valid certificate. So these four steps have been put into the Python script that is called Certgrinder, and it's not a lot of code, and it's pretty easy to understand, and it's maybe a few hundred lines of Python or something. Okay, so that's basically how you get certificates. It works brilliantly when I create a new server that needs a certificate, I just go add a CNAME record to DNS containing the host name and pointing it to the Certgrinder server, which then has a listening DNS server and handles the challenges there. So when the CSR grinder script is called, the DNS server has already, with an NS update, dynamically created the record and added the challenge in it. So when Let's Encrypt checks, it's there waiting. That is basically it. It's incredibly simple, and I don't understand why maybe it isn't actually built into Certbot or something like that. But you need the Certgrinder server needs to have either a web server or a DNS server or both. And it needs to be accessible over SSH for all the clients, all the servers that need certificates. And that's it. Then you can get certificates without even opening anything up for the servers that need the certificates. Only the Certgrinder server needs to listen to traffic from, say, untrusted sources. Let's Encrypt does not provide a list of the IP address they use to do the challenges from, so you have to open up at least the well-known location for the entire internet, and in some super secure setups, that's just not an option because of corporate rules and stuff. You cannot open firewalls from the outside and way deep into your network. So with this, you can still get valid certificates properly and pretty much without any risk of compromise. So since I got this running, I've added some more features because, well, why not? Certgrinder knows where the public keys are, it knows where the certificates are because they have predictable file names. So I've added some switches to output TLSA records. TLSA records are public key fingerprints that are put into DNS, which software can then look up and see if it is the public key they expect to find. So with a TLSA record, you can make sure that you are talking to the server you expect. And since my Certgrinder software knows about the keys and domains and everything, then it can easily output the TLSA records I need to put into DNS, and it can also look up in DNS to see if they are correct. And I just run this every night. I have a nightly maintenance script that checks for package vulnerabilities and stuff. And it also checks my TLSA records and sends me an email with what needs to be done, if anything. So it'll just say, this TLSA record is missing for imap.bornhack.org. You should add this in DNS and then include it in the email. So alerts should always be immediately actionable. And in this way they are. So TLSA records are, with this syntax, it's like SRV records. So the port name and the protocol and then the host name. So you just run it with -show TLSA or check TLSA, and if it's a web server, __444._TCP, and it'll check and output the TLSA records you need. And a similar feature is -show SPKI, which does the same thing, reads the public keys, and then outputs the SHA-256 SPKI pins. This standard was originally made for HTTP public key pinning, which was briefly considered, but it turned out it was much too dangerous because if you lose your certificate, you have to have double pin sets and stuff, and it was too complicated and too many people got it wrong. But the standard hung around and is being used in a few other places, so Certgrinder can output those as well. I mean, all this can be done with OpenSSL and stuff as well, but since I have these switches, I can automate it, and then I actually get it done. Many of these things, you add a new server and you're in a hurry, and the last thing you're thinking about is to add TLSA records for the certificates in DNS. And with this, every certificate that is added is every domain that is added to a CSR and in a certificate is automatically checked, and I get alerted if something is wrong. And I believe that putting pins in DNS is a really good way to raise security. We just need more client software to support it, of course. But the start must be to actually have the records there. So, okay. So it gets certificates. It can output some. It has some convenience methods, and that is basically it. It's not supposed to grow into. I think the whole Certbot stuff, where it tries to manage your web server configs and stuff, is a bit crazy. It's never going to do. stuff like that. It's basically just going to be a certificate manager. I actually put in the description of this talk that 1.0 had just been released, but because I expected that it would have been by now. I'm still missing one feature that I want to do, and that is limiting which domains an SSH key can request a certificate for. So on the Certgrinder server, you have a standard SSH authorized keys file where all the Certgrinder clients have their own line. They're limited by IP address, and they are, with the force command, forced to just be able to run the Certgrinder CSR grinder binary, or not binary, script, the executable. But at the moment, there's no limit to. So if I have mail.bornhack.org and imap.bornhack.org and webserver.bornhack.org, then at the moment there's no nothing limiting. If the web server got hacked, it would also be able to get a certificate for imap.bornhack.org, because the Certgrinder server does not limit which SSH key is allowed to get certificates for which domains, because all the challenges are forwarded to the Certgrinder server. So there's no limit to, that's how you can get certificates for domains that still point to the old server's IP, because you can just allow the domain and then do the challenge, it'll get redirected to the Certgrinder server and it'll just work. So you can get certificates basically on any server for any host name where you are able to put the challenge into DNS or the CNAME redirect into DNS. So that's, and it's really not a lot of code, but I've been busy doing BornHack and stuff, so it hasn't quite happened yet, but it will. And that's it for 1.0. In the future, I would love to see it packaged on PyPy and some of the operating system packet managers, because at the moment I just have an Ansible role to install it all, which works well for me, but it would be nice to have it in the package managers. I am using the Python OpenSSL package at the moment to do the certificate reading and outputting stuff. And I would like to switch to the cryptography, to using that directly, because the PyOpenSSL is a bit annoying sometimes. I'm also, like I said, I'm using the LetsEncrypt's own certbot program, and I think I would like to switch to using ACME, the Python ACME package, which the certbot program is based on, directly, because it gets a bit fiddly with the command line stuff and the command line switches and stuff. And finally, the CSR grinder, the server part, which is at the moment a 30-40 line shell script. I would like to rewrite that in Python just to get some better logging facilities and better, and also because the rest is Python, so why not? And that is pretty much it. I can't really think of much more to add to this. It works really, really well. It's very convenient. And I'd rather keep it small and lean and easy to handle. So I think that is more or less it. I've written a pretty comprehensive README on the web in the GitHub repo, because it can be a bit hard to get your head around the whole challenge thing, and even I wrote the software can sometimes get confused over. I mean, so your the DNS for your domain points to an IP address, and that's of course where the challenge will go, and then you do a redirect on HTTP level if you're using the HTTP 01, or in DNS, then you do a CNAME pointed at the zone that the Certgrinder server is handling, and then it'll get handled there. And it can all be a bit complex, but I've really put some work into the README, so try to read that, and also come and find me, because I can probably help you out getting it up and going. So, any questions? Well, I must have covered it pretty well.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Thank you.